Welcome, all souls. I'm Reverend Louise Green, pronoun she, her. It's good to be with you for Memorial Day weekend in the US, time of remembrance and that cultural beginning of summer. In pandemic times, we try circumstances require it. I'm here online as I recover from COVID, voice a little more husky. And we may have a few hybrid tech glitches, and maybe not. If I lose my Wi-Fi, Kathleen will take the wheel. If there is sound or image delay, just take some extra breaths. The service today is one of deeper contemplation. The readings will be longer and more reflective, the sermon shorter. Today's wonderful musical duo, Vanessa and Alex, will invite you to breathe and relax with harp and voice. Our call to the sacred space comes from Nigerian writer Bayo Akomolafe. We all struggle with orienting ourselves in this time of greater collective fear. And he suggests that disruption points us to a crossroads, where we may linger in order to go deeper into new ways of being. These are his words. May this decade be remembered as the strange path, the third way, the broken binary, the traversal disruption, the kairotic moment, the post-human movement for emancipation, the gift of disorientation that opened up new places of power and of slow limbs. May we be slower than speed could calculate, and swifter than the pull of the gravity of words can incarcerate. May we be visited so thoroughly and met in wild places so overwhelmingly that we are left undone, ready for composting, ready for the impossible. Blessings as we gather slowly for meditation and worship, exploring the power of rest. Amen.
In Unitarian Universalist churches all over the country, we kindle a chalice flame to mark the time. Today we kindle this flame for the light of truth. May it shine brightly on us. We kindle this flame for the fire of commitment. May it embolden us to just action. And we kindle this flame for the warmth of community. May it nourish and sustain us through these troubling times. Welcome. Let's join together with our opening hymn, number 90. From all the fret and fever of the day, if you are comfortable to rise in body and or spirit.
Let there be moments. Welcome to All Souls Church. Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Ed Novak, and I'll be your worship associate for today's special service. For that, we're thankful for the musicians who will be leading us today, Vanessa Young and Alex Bodenham. As you just heard, Reverend Louise Green is still at home quarantining after contracting COVID, and we look forward to her recovery and return. For 200 years, our congregation has sought to live up to the vision inherent in our name, All Souls. It's a vision of a human community where all people are welcome at the table, where the divisions that separate us in our daily lives come tumbling down and we recognize ourselves as part of one human family. And we're a congregation that's no longer defined by the walls of its sanctuary. We see you, Zoomers, on the West Coast, up and down the Eastern Seaboard, the South, the Midwest, across the DMV, and in other countries. And if you're on Zoom, let us know in the chat where you're from. Also, for those of you in the sanctuary, if any of you are on Zoom, we're going to ask you to log off. Apparently, that's a thing, and it causes feedback issues. Also, for those of you in the sanctuary, to access today's order of service, you can either scan the QR code on the left, on the back, in front of the pew in front of you, or ask an usher for a printed copy. If you're on Zoom, you can click on the link in the chat. Our weekly email bulletin is the best way to find out the latest news. You can sign up through the link posted in the chat or on the All Souls website. After today's service, everyone in the sanctuary is welcome to gather for fellowship on the steps of the church or on the terrace. And everyone joining us on Zoom can simply stay online for fellowship. Also, we want to welcome visitors to our nation's capital on this holiday weekend. Welcome. All Souls has become a thriving global faith community. To embrace our wider community, our greeting has become a beholding, in person and virtually. If you're on Zoom, put your Zoom screen on gallery view and scroll through the faces, wave, and say hello in the chat. I encourage everyone in the sanctuary to get up and move around, greeting one another as you're comfortable. If you'd prefer to keep your distance, you might want to choose a gesture and smile with your eyes. Welcome to All Souls Church. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. And again, welcome to All Souls Church.
Search growth, the dragonfly hangs like a blue thread loosened from the sky. So
how lovely. Thank you so much. Greetings, All Souls. I'm Reverend Kathleen Rolenz, pronouns she, her, hers, and I am serving as your interim senior minister. It is so good to be here with you in person and online. This is the time of year when our church begins to enter a different pace of activity. But I also want to acknowledge that the work and the play of the church never stops. It just shifts a bit. So there are a couple of announcements and events that I want to draw to your attention first before we explore or before we go into our congregational concerns. Of course, this is Memorial Day weekend, a weekend in which we express our deep gratitude for those who gave their lives in service to this country. And it is an opportunity to mourn our dead and to honor those in military service. In today's religious education classes, our kindergarten through fifth graders, with the help of their older peers, are learning about the origins of Memorial Day and are building a memorial garden on the playground, which is over here. The display memorializes Unitarian Universalists who have gone before us, including some from our own congregation. And so after the service today, you are invited to stroll through the garden on the playground. I also want to acknowledge that last December, Ebony Peace, our intern and members of our Black Souls community, offered a really beautiful, powerful Kwanzaa service. Tonight at 7 to 8:30, Ebony is hosting a class on Zoom about Kwanzaa, which of course is celebrated in December, but the principles are meant to be embodied all year long. All are welcome to attend. The link to the class can be found on the homepage of the church's website. Speaking of the church's website calendar, please do not forget to register for next Sunday's annual meeting. It will be held at 1:30 p.m. on Zoom only. This is the meeting where the church elects new leaders and, most importantly, passes the budget for 2022-2023. So we need to ensure a quorum of voting members. Please plan to attend. And finally, this is just a save the date announcement. The Poor People's Campaign will be here in full force on Saturday, June 18th, and Unitarian Universalists will meet up between 9:30 and 10 at 4th Street and Pennsylvania Avenue Northwest on that day. There's going to be a lot of information about this in the e-newsletter on the website, but make sure that you save this date because it's going to be an important event to attend and turn out for. Likewise, there are some events and particularly four memorial services that are held in the month of June in different locations that we want to remind you of. The service for Julius Sales will be on June 4th. June 11th, there'll be two services, Mark Herzog and Robert Troutman, respectively. And June 18th, Brian Barger. All of that information can be found in the church's website and in the e-newsletter. So that concludes the announcement portion. But now I want to shift. I want to shift into our time of congregational concerns. You know, we often quote the William Blake reading when he writes that joy and woe are woven fine. And so I want to begin our congregational and community concerns time with a joy and a milestone that we celebrate in the life of one of our own, the Reverend Louise Green. Reverend Louise Green was ordained 30 years ago last month. She began her ministerial career as a United Church of Christ minister, but transitioned over to the Unitarian Universalists. Their loss, our gain. I'm wondering if we can show our appreciation for Reverend Louise. There she is. A delay. I see that now. Wow. Okay. Congratulations, Reverend Louise. And again, we wish you a continued speedy recovery. Oh, this has been a difficult week in the life of this nation and in one of our own members' lives, and I want to acknowledge that first. Sherry Gilbert's daughter, Mara, informed her of the death by suicide of one of her dear friends and a roommate, Axel, just this week. And our hearts are with Mara, with Axel's family, and with Sherry as we grieve and as they grieve this terrible loss. Friends, as we were planning this week's service, all of us acknowledged the unbearable grief caused by this most recent massacre at the Robb Elementary School on Tuesday. We have lit 21 candles on the altar and have the names of all those persons killed that terrible day. But if any time during today's service you feel the need to come up and light a candle and say a prayer, please feel free to do so. In some ways, there are no words to speak to the unspeakable. So I hearken back to two sources for today's prayer. The first from our own A. Powell Davies, who wrote, "When there is nothing to guide me in the present, help me, O God, to be guided by the insights of the past. Let not bereavement blind me to what is still good and lovely. Let me see it through my tears until again I see it plainly." And as I wrote in this week's column, I return to the ancient voices of the Psalms, and I offer you now this prayer of rage and lamentation and hope. Please, pray with me. How long, O Lord, how long must we endure this endless cycle? Carnage, thoughts, prayers, vigils, names, rinse, repeat. Marches, protests, demands for action falling on deaf ears. How long, O Lord, must we endure this senseless violence? And besides, when did violence ever make sense? Not to the wounded, the dying, the dead. Not to the parents, the children, the families. Not to a country mourning and keening, weeping and wondering how long. There is a place for righteous rage, and there is a place for keening lamentation. May we bring both to this moment. May this holy anger illuminate the hearts of the most hard-hearted politicians. May these laments sear our souls with the lasting hope that you, O thou Spirit of life, will beat our swords and our guns into plowshares. And we shall study guns and violence no more. Help us, O Holy Spirit, to see a way where there is no path. Give us to hear music when our own songs cease. And when the warm touch of life forsakes us and our courage melts away, May we stumble in darkness until we find our rest in thee. O thou Spirit of life, come unto us this day. Amen.
I welcome you into our first reading and a time of reflection. Bayo Akomolafe is a Nigerian author, speaker, teacher who lives in India and names himself as a trans public intellectual. From Let Us Make Sanctuary, an interview with Bayo Akomolafe on podcast Insight at the Edge with Tammy Simon. The times are urgent. Let us slow down. The times are urgent. Let us slow down. I'm always at pain to explain what I mean. When people hear me, they feel, that's good advice. I'll take a break, or I'll do yoga, or I'll say more prayers just before I get to the desk, or something like that. It's not quite the same as taking a break. There is something more about this. Modernity has a story. Let me boil it down to three myths. We're stable, we're found, we're coherent. All we need to do is keep progressing along these rationalistic techno-bureaucratic lines
All we need to do is to depend on our own genius, and then everything will be fine. But once in a while, we are reminded of how things fall apart. We are reminded when the language with which we frame our future feels exhausted, outworn. Nothing makes sense anymore. When cracks appear in the ground and there's no walking forward anymore, there's no progress. Slowing down is touching our indebtedness, touching the entangling threads, the tentacularities that connect us to the earth, that connect us to ancestry, that connect us to the modern human, the non-human, the yet to be human. The invitation to slow down at the crossroads is actually not an invitation that is framed for individuals to apply. It's not about you. It's not about your individual trajectory towards salvation. It's much more about lingering at the crossroads. And it's about the collective, the irreducibly collective, the manifold, the parliament of voices. It's a prayer, actually. When we say the times are urgent, let us slow down, it's a prayer to modern humans to create new kinds of bodies. That's the invitation here. The times are urgent. Let us go slowly into the sanctuary. The times are urgent. Let us be slowed down by the beings that exceed us. The times are urgent. Let us be defeated by the things we cannot understand. The times are urgent. Let us diffract our ways of knowing. The times are urgent. Let us be released from the traps of the things we already know. Those are the invocations.
Before we take today's offering, just a couple of reminders. First, it's never too late to make a financial commitment to support the ministry and mission of All Souls through a pledge that is small, grande, or venti. Second, as we approach the end of our fiscal year, the time is never better to fulfill your current pledge, which my wife and I did yesterday. If you have questions, contact Gary Penn. For today's offering, you can donate online through the All Souls website or through the link in the chat. You can also text ASCU to 73256. The ushers in our sanctuary will be passing the plate. Today's offering will now be received. Thank you for your generosity.
Our second reading is by Alexis Pauline Gums, who calls herself a queer Black troublemaker and Black feminist love evangelist, aspirational cousin to all sentient beings. And it is from Undrowned, Black Feminist Lessons from Marine Mammals. Are you still breathing? This is an offering towards our evolution, towards the possibility that instead of continuing the trajectory of slavery, entrapment, separation, and domination, and making our atmosphere unbreathable, we might instead practice another way to breathe. I don't know what that will look like, but I do know that as our marine mammal kindred, that our marine mammal kindred are amazing at not drowning. So I call on them as teachers, mentors, guides, and I call on you as breathing kindred souls. May we evolve. There is a time to rest, like sea elephants who spend a whole month just snuggling and shedding their skin, pusa seals who dive deeper postpartum and spend more time alone, gray seals who offer a third of their body weight while nursing and then leave to regenerate themselves. This argues the urgency of rest, the necessity of regeneration, and the depth rest reveals and allows. There are layers of myself I need to shed now, and rest is the only way to be renewed. 1 month of summer, I'll be home, becoming something iridescent, vulnerable, older, and new. And you? I wish for you the sacredness of rest, expansive, sprawling rest, uninterrupted. I love the part of you that is emerging under everything. You deserve to rest long enough to let whatever go. I'm with you, and I will wait to see the silver rest of you before you dive again.
During my ongoing COVID home staycation, I have been reading Undrowned and listening to Let Us Make Sanctuary. In my uncomfortable assortment of symptoms and overall fatigue, I had fewer defenses. I was just too tired for business as usual, and so I yielded to the disorienting and murky flow of sleep, rest. The provocative challenges from both writers that we have heard were moving in like water, seeping into my usual systems and drawing me gradually into slower being. I was ready to linger at the crossroads. Yesterday, I finally got out of the house, still testing faint positive, so I wore my mask when people were near. There was perfect sparkling sunshine in DC after days of cloud and rain. The air was fresh and cool and the sound of water enticing. It was my first time beyond the yard in 10 days and my legs were kind of wobbly. Therefore, I walked very slowly along the water's edge at Rock Creek National Park, my regular landscape of restoration. I stood on the edge of Milk House Ford, an old crossroads in the early 1900s, very near where our All Souls picnic will be. This is about 7 miles up Rock Creek from the Potomac River, which flows 112 miles to the Atlantic Ocean. Now, this water crossing once had a raised brick roadway for carriages, horses, and eventually cars. A sign shows this 1960 black and white photo with one of those old-fashioned wood-paneled station wagons going one way, a horse and rider crossing another way, and the waters lapping up and rising over. The humanly engineered Milk House Ford carried much new traffic across the creek waters. It also cut off the ancient path of the alewife and blueback herring communities from the river and the sea. Generations of fish were unable to pass higher than that anthropocentric brick road to return to their own ancestral spawning grounds in Upper Rock Creek. And the species declined in the blocked waters. In more recent decades, that raised road at Milk House Ford was removed and the Herring Highway restored. Boulder step pools for jumping fish were built in other sections of the creek, and these human sewage pipes submerged and covered. One has to ask, why did they have open sewer pipes into Rock Creek? But those were underground now. You can still sit on these high back stone seats that are on either side of the river where carriages once stopped at Milk House Ford. And you can see this submerged brick pathway disappear. It's like there are 100 years of history present in the air and underwater. You could wade in and swim across the currents, but that human crossroad is gone. So I walked over instead down the road and around at Beach Drive, where there's a bridge mostly populated by bikes, strollers, walking and running humans, and a lot of dogs. On the far side of the creek, the path to that old stone seat was partially submerged as well because of these recent heavy rains. So I stood at the beach, taking in the water, the sky, the sun, the sound. A beautiful little enclosed area. When I looked down at the sand, an unexpected sight delighted me. 5 beautiful tiger swallowtail butterflies, vivid yellow and black, were on the beach in a cheerful little group, about 3 inches from one another. They moved in various formations of 5, walking on the ground, sometimes flattening completely and showing this intricate mosaic wing pattern. We paused together for some time, 5 butterflies and a slow human. I kept expecting them to fly or at least leave this configuration. They stayed hovering and walking. And I stayed waiting, and we were in slow rest together. Eventually, I turned carefully, started to walk away. After a few steps, I looked back. They were up in the air, swirling now, widening into this pattern that was 10 feet across. All 5 were still in a kind of harmony, making loops in the air as I gazed on their flight. We were lingering at the crossroads together, communicating the delicate beauty of the moment, the fresh feeling of moving more freely. I've been to this spot many times, yet never at this deliberate pace. Not with such a slow pause necessitated by my own body limitations and inspired by that perfect beauty of the Saturday. Never with 5 butterflies who waited with me to see if I might notice something beyond my solo human self. Milk House Ford as brick has disappeared. The damage it did undone. And humans cannot cross Rock Creek there in the way we could even 50 years ago. Something has been lost in that way to travel closed. And yet a new way has opened, one that creates passage for herring, for humans, space for butterflies, and holding this more unified landscape in greater harmony. Bayo Akomalape suggests that slowing down can be this multi-layered recalculation of everything, a humble yielding to the impasse in which humans find themselves, and a remembering of ancient ways of being. As we heard, he wrote, slowing down is touching our indebtedness, touching the entangling threads, the tentacularities that connect us to the earth, that connect us to ancestry, that connect us to the modern human, the non-human, the yet to be human. It's much more about lingering at the crossroads, he says, and it's about the collective, the irreducibly collective, the manifold, the parliament of voices. It's a prayer, actually. This is my prayer at our collective crossroads, that we find the power of rest. Reconnect to a world which is radiant with beauty and abundant with grace. And our grief and confusion, our despair and weariness, we must find ways to renew. The human world systems are indeed devolving. Climate emergency is upon us. We are challenged to stay present in an age of collective fear, where the future is much more uncertain and destabilized. I want to stay attentive to the suffering of our communities and not turn away. Anyone with a compassionate heart is aware of what is being lost. And our values absolutely call us to take skillful action where we can. However, there is more than can possibly be digested at any given hour or day. And the last 2 weeks feel particularly heavy in this country. We are collectively weary. We wait together, vulnerable in the emergence of the new, surrounded by the destruction of all that which will no longer hold steady. And yet, this also holds the potential for human liberation, to be free to remember who we were and who we might become again. A quote I saw this week said, we are all together in the gutter, in the trenches, yet some have their eyes on the stars. This is remembering our ancestors who saw those very same star patterns above us, all the earth elements below. And shining in those stars is a way of being which holds deeper rest. Not some place that we visit at church, vacation, yoga, or the park. Alexis Pauline Gums writes of the urgency of rest, the depth that rest reveals and allows. Rest is the only way to be renewed. She told us all so tenderly, I wish for you the sacredness of rest. Expansive, sprawling rest, uninterrupted. I love the part of you that is emerging under everything. You deserve to rest long enough to let whatever go. What keeps you going? For me, it is a radical decision to slow down and rest. Embrace the limitations of the human body, set down illusions of individual salvation, and heal what must be healed. To savor the depth of community and receive this very wide embrace of ancestors and elements, to plumb the expansive power of rest while committing to collective weaving at the crossroads. There is a source which is inexhaustible. There is a spirit which resides within and without. We are inextricable from the woven web, the interdependence of all, which is both terrible and beautiful. All our relations, as First Nations tell us. A skyscape that we already inhabit in the stars, and a planetary landscape that holds us as creatures among many other beings. May you find your true source of wisdom and renew. May you find your way to the power of rest. Blessed be. Amen.
Our closing hymn is number 83. It's a beautiful hymn called Winds Be Still. And I invite you to rise as willing and able and join together in this hymn. Once again, we are so grateful that you are here, and we do invite you to share some fellowship either in the courtyard or the terrace, and certainly on the playground to see what the children have created for Memorial Day. But I leave you with these words of benediction. For all the hard things we endure, for all the sorrows we bear, for all griefs which abound, we must remember another truth. There is a love holding us. There is a love holding all we love. There is a love holding all. May we rest well in that love. Rest well, friends. Amen and blessed be.